Hi, welcome to Five Facts with Danny. That's me, I'm Danny. And tonight, I am out in my backyard on a beautiful August evening, and I'm hoping to see some moths. Now, there are 12,000 different species of moths that live in North America. And as with all things, no matter where you live, there are some that are more common and some that are less common. And one of those less common species is called the darling underwing. I've been reading up on the darling underwing, and I'm really excited about the possibility of maybe seeing one, although acknowledging that they are pretty rare. So while I'm out here waiting for the moths to come out, I have for you five facts about the darling underwing. Here we go. Fact number one, the scientific name for the darling underwing moth is Catocala cara. Now, scientific name, this is the genus and the species. This is something that every species on the entire planet has. They have a genus and a species. And this scientific name gives us our first clue to what the darling underwing looks like. So let's get nerdy for a second. The species name cara is Latin for darling. Now that makes sense since the darling underwing has the word darling literally in its name. Now the genus name here, it comes from two different Greek words, so we're going to split this down the middle here. Kato is the Greek word for under or behind, and kala is the Greek word for beauty. So under, there is beauty on this darling moth. Okay, but under what there is beauty? Well, as you might have surmised, it's under the wing, which brings us to fact number two. The darling underwing exhibits something called flash coloration. Now what this means is that when it's at rest, the darling underwing looks pretty bland and unremarkable. So the darling underwing specifically has brown and black, and it kind of looks like the bark of a tree. However, as soon as it takes off, as soon as it flies, we are treated to a beautiful flash of bright colors. This is a trait in all underwings. They all have these bright colors underneath their wings. On the darling underwing specifically, their underwing has bright red scarlet stripes. Fact number three, the way the darling underwing protects itself from predators is with another technique, which also has the word coloration in it, deflective coloration. So, as we mentioned, when it's at rest, the darling underwing kind of looks like the bark of a tree, and lo and behold, most of the time they're resting up against a tree, and so that works really well as camouflage. However, if that camouflage isn't working and a predator is still getting closer and closer, then the darling underwing is going to take off, and that bright flash of color on its underwing is going to distract the predator, hopefully anyways, if this deflective coloration works. So that bright color is what that predator is going to go for, because it's going to be the easiest thing for it to see, the easiest thing for it to spot or grab. And if, unfortunately, the predator does get a hold of that bright underwing, the moth is still going to be okay because there's no vital organs under there. It can lose its underwing and still survive. Fact number four, entomologists seem to like a good theme. So the first underwings were described by Carl Linnaeus, the famous taxonomist who named so many of the species that we're familiar with today. And ever since, they've always followed this theme. The theme you might notice from some of these names, we've got the betrothed underwing, the little wife underwing, the girlfriend underwing, the widow underwing. They all have to do with women and marriage, or some combination thereof. Now, there are a lot of underwings, so once they started to run out of some of these more obvious adjectives for underwings, they started to use some words that, you know, you could say maybe describe a woman on her wedding day. For example, graceful, the charming underwing, and then, of course, that's how we landed today with the darling underwing. And finally, fact number five. There are a lot of different ways to see and attract moths to your backyard, but if you're looking for underwings, your best bet is to create a sugary bait. Now, I didn't have any fermented fruit lying around, but I did have fermented something else. That's kind of the fun part about being a naturalist, is that you always get to experiment and try new things. So we'll see what happens. I took some of the beer from the back of my fridge, mixed it in with some brown sugar, stirred it all together, and used a brush to paint it all over the fence in my backyard. If you've got a fence, this is great. Moths like to land on surfaces like fences. If you have trees, even better. And best if you're looking for darling underwings are poplars and willows. If you have those, cover that tree with some of your bait, and who knows, you could be in business to see some underwings. So now I just wait and see if the moths are going to come visit me tonight. As for me, lots of moths here tonight, but no underwings so far, which just means I got to keep on the lookout. If you happen to see any cool moths, and especially if you happen to spot a darling underwing, be sure to let us know at the Urban Ecology Center, and we'll see you for the next one. Happy mothing!